Today is June 1st, 2020, and here we have our state representative, Jing Wu, who serves as a member in the Texas House. Thank you so much for your time today.
Appreciate it. Thank you so much.
It has been almost 7 years since your first interview with us, right? So to start, would you please give us a little bit update about yourself, like your recent job, your advocacy work, or what kind of social issues have you been involved recently?
Sure. So I was elected in 2012, sworn in 2013. This is now my fourth term, my eighth year in the Texas legislature. And for people who don't know, I represent Southwest Houston in House District 137. It's a large immigrant district. 70-80% of the people here speak a language other than English, including myself. 40% of the adults here were born outside of the United States, including me. It's an incredibly diverse area, and I'm very proud to represent it. In terms of work, outside of my state rep job, I'm an attorney. I'm a private attorney. I represent kids, both in the Child Protective Services court system, and also kids in the juvenile delinquency system, kids who get arrested for doing bad stuff. In terms of my advocacy, I've taken on a lot of things. Not surprisingly, I'm a big advocate for immigrant rights, for refugee rights, and for any number of diverse communities, including Muslim Americans, South Asians, including just people from across the spectrum who don't normally have a lot of representation because they deserve representation, and a lot of them live in my district. So some of my main focus in the legislature, I've really focused on, not surprisingly, given my work, I focus on kids. And what this means is I do a lot of work in reforming the juvenile justice system. And some in the adult criminal system. I focus a lot on reforming the CPS system. I also work on some other issues throughout, and you don't have enough time for me to go through all of them. But needless to say, a lot of it is focused on children. And also, my other real big role in the legislature is I'm an appropriator. I sit on the House Appropriations Committee, and we help decide how much the money and where the state spends its money.
That's great. So I guess my next question is, as you know, since March, Harris County has issued a stay-at-home order. So I guess, in what ways has the coronavirus pandemic impacted your life or your work?
Sure. In terms of my day job as an attorney, it's actually affected me a lot because the courts are shut down, and it's made dealing with child protective services cases and juvenile delinquency cases very difficult. Especially since there are many COVID positive cases of kids in juvenile lockup, and this has made going to the courthouse, especially dangerous. And I have immune compromised people within my household, so I can't, it's not just about me. In terms of my job as state rep, it actually has dramatically increased my workload. So the state legislature is meant to be a part-time job. Especially since we're paid like $600 a month to do it, and we only meet in the legislative session once every other year. But, we still have day-to-day responsibilities in our district and in the legislature. We have appropriation, like, for example, I have appropriations duties, and we have to watch the budget, we have to take care of things, we have to watch over issues, even during the interim. And also, part of what I've been doing a lot in during the crisis as state rep is helping our constituents navigate the crisis. We have had a tremendous number of people call into us asking for help on unemployment issues, asking us where to go get tested, needing help on finding food. And, you know, even people outside of the district, I actually have directed my staff that if somebody calls in and they don't live in our district, we're going to help them anyways. We're not going to push them off to another member when we can help them, if we can help them right there and then. And we're going to take care of them as much as possible. Because sometimes, because I have a very maybe larger than life footprint on social media, people see my name and then they call my office, not knowing that they have their own state rep. But we don't push anybody away. If they need help, we'll try to get them help right now. But I've also spent a tremendous amount of time in the last couple of months locating PPE and getting a hold of it, figuring out where it needs to go, and then delivering it. So my life for the last like 2 or 3 months now has been all about masks. I know very intimate details of the differences between a KN95 and an N95. But for the most part, the simple answer is we help people. That's my job.
That's great. So besides your work, what kind of things have you personally done in response to the outbreak?
That's a hard question to ask because I can't really separate out my personal life from my state rep life. I don't have a clock. Like there's no punch out for when I'm not a state rep, and for when this is like me time. The reality it is everything that you do is sort of related to the job. You know, I can get calls at midnight, you know, about state rep stuff, and you just have to respond to it. There's no off time. So, you know, personally, my response has been just trying to take care of myself. My mom lives with me. My mother-in-law is real close to us, and then, you know, my dad's around, and I got to make sure they stay alive. I don't want to, you know, I have to go out to places and see people and do things and host food giveaways and mask giveaways and whatever else, but I have to take extra responsibility to make sure, like, I am careful about the way I contact people, not shaking hands, washing my hands. You know, as soon as you come home, you take a shower and you change your clothes, throw the clothes in the laundry, because you don't, any way we can minimize risk, we have to do it.
Okay. Since you mentioned your family are around with you, I'm wondering, do you think the outbreak of the pandemic has affected the relationship between you and your family and your loved ones?
I guess. Not really. I mean, the only real big difference that's occurred is that I make dinner every single night. That's about it. Usually I kind of like split that up with my mom. But now since like February, since the lockdown, I've been responsible for making dinner every single night, which is something I enjoy, but still, that's about the only difference. I mean, like, you know, for the most part, either lucky or unlucky, we've not been cooped up because, like, I don't have the luxury of not going out. I have to go out and respond to things and take care of things. And my wife is a reporter, so she has to go out and go cover stuff and respond to stuff. So we don't have the luxury of not going out. So not a whole lot has changed. It's kind of one of the ironies, like especially during like Hurricane Harvey and other things, is where when other people are less busy, we are more busy.
I see. And let's change gear a little bit. Sure. Have you been hearing about like assumptions made about the Asian community as being more prone to the virus?
So I'm sorry, I didn't understand your question.
Oh, so how do you feel about like assumptions made about the Asian communities as being more prone to the virus, like some racist attacks against Asians? Yeah.
So that's actually been another thing that I've spent a lot of time tackling I've taken a lot of press calls and been a part of a lot of teleconferences over the issue of anti-Asian hate, and increased Asian anti-Asian crimes and actions all around the United States. But look, it's complicated, and this is at minimum a problem that goes back long before coronavirus. That I've talked about this in a sense of, look, this is just coming to a head of the way Asian Americans are seen and treated in the United States. That, you know, we have all these people who talk about the coronavirus, and there's no distinction between what happens in China and Asian Americans. I'm not even saying Chinese Americans, I'm saying Asian Americans, because number one, no, most non-Asian people have no idea what the differences are and cannot tell the difference between Chinese, Korean, Japanese, Vietnamese. You know, the family who was attacked in Midland, in the Panhandle, they're Burmese. And, you know, most any Asian American would tell you, like, yeah, Burmese don't look anything like Chinese, and why would you ever mistake them for being Chinese? But for most non-Asians, they're like, they don't know the difference, they don't care. And the second part of that is, this has been the struggle of Asian Americans since there were such things as Asian Americans, is that no matter what we do in life, no matter how successful we are, no matter how good our English is, how big of a business empire we build, how much money we donate, we'll never be American enough. We'll always be outsiders. We'll always be alien. People look at us and they always ask, where are you from? And if you say Houston, they'll go, no, where are you really from? And it's that sort of underlying bigotry that people may not understand or even know that it's racist. But, you know, if you talk to a Black person and they say, well, I'm from Houston, you wouldn't say, oh, no, where in Africa are you really from? Or if you talk to someone who's Hispanic, it's like, no, where in Latin America are you really from? You would only do that to Asians. And this is a part of it. The fears over coronavirus are part of it, is that not only do people not care about the differences between Asian groups, but all Asians somehow are suspect. They're disease carriers. They somehow have something to do with it because they're not really in our community and they're not really from here. They're not really with us. And another big thing that I've been doing the last few months is spending a lot of time being a part of community donations from the Asian community to hospitals, to clinics, to the city, to the county. And a lot of the groups will not come out and say it. But to me, and behind closed doors, they'll say, you know, you need to make sure they know that we're doing this because we're good Americans, that we're part of the community. And because they're genuinely scared. I've never seen the community this scared before. And they're doing everything they can to prove that they're good Americans. And while I appreciate their work, I am disgusted and just sickened that they have to prove it.
I see. You mentioned that there seems to be a historical root in people's perceptions on Asian Americans. I'm wondering, how do you think this pandemic has amplified this kind of misconception? Or
a favorite movie of mine, documentary, and anybody who's watching should look it up. It's called Searching for General Tso, and it's about food, but it's not really about food. It's about the Asian American experience, starting from the railroad, starting from the gold rush, and the types of discrimination that we've experienced throughout history. And there's a reason why there's as many Chinese food restaurants as there are McDonald's in America. And it has a lot to do with, because legally, the Chinese were only allowed to open restaurants and laundries. Work that was designated for women, right, at the time. Because, you know, that was the type of demeaning attitude they had towards Asians, towards Chinese, whatever you want to call it. And there's a lot of history behind it, and there's a lot of subtle racism that we see the result of today, but we don't really understand where it comes from, and we sort of just accept it. And I think it's important that if you care about this, go watch it. Go read a book. It's called Driven Out. It's an important book. It's a historical, it documents the history of the Chinese and other Asian American groups around the time of the enactment of the Chinese Exclusion Act, right? And, you know, but this is not, again, I want to say, like, woe is me. This is all about Chinese people. No, this country has a long history of discrimination against immigrant groups, whether it's the Irish, the Polish, the Germans, the Mexicans, Guatemalans, the Chinese, the Japanese. This is the history of America. And I think one of the important things is, you know, that we should learn something from it. And I hope we learn something from it, because we seem to forget the lessons. Every few years, we seem to repeat the same things over and over again, without changing.
Yeah, that's great. So how social media has played a role in this pandemic, as to now, like, Trump is inflicting more control over it? Like, I mean, play a role in amplifying this kind of social?
I think the big difference between now and, let's say, 20 years ago is social media. 20 years ago, most people would have gotten their news from the newspaper, from like ABC, NBC, Nightly News, something like that, where there would be fact checkers, where there would be people who would say, no, 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 this is what the correct answer is. If you're hearing something else, that's wrong. But, you know, BuzzFeed had a recent post where they documented all like 40-something different hoaxes or false things that are being posted about just the George Floyd protests, right? And I would be scared even to consider that there might, like, how would you even put together the number of hoaxes surrounding coronavirus? Because everybody freely posts false information, because there's so many people who have news sites that, you know, at the very, very fine print, they'll say it's a parody, but it's just to generate clicks, and they write outrageous things, but people retweet it, and then they repost it as if it was fact, without checking it, without looking at the source, without looking at anything. And there's really not a lot of desire by our leadership to counteract it, because they kind of benefit from it. And I think that's extremely unfortunate that we don't have a White House that actively pursues the truth and actively pushes back against hoaxes and scams and false narratives.
Do you think that has also contributed to amplifying the racial conflicts?
Yeah, sure. I think more so than ever. So, you know, like, this is, I'm maybe being a bit of an old man here, but like, back in the old days, if you had crazy racist things to say, you had to like do a newsletter or just mail people, and your reach was limited, because your resources were limited. Now, all you have to do is create an anonymous Twitter handle, right? And you can send out as much hate as you want, and at no cost, at literally zero cost. Maybe the cost of the electricity that's in your phone, right? But With the internet comes anonymity. With anonymity goes responsibility, because if you're anonymous, there is no consequence. So people are more free to generate hate, right? And there's been, every once in a while, someone will get doxxed and they'll find out who they are and they'll post it and they'll lose their job and they'll be embarrassed that they were posting neo-Nazi stuff. But that's few and far between. The most of the people posting tremendous amounts of hate go without any consequences. And I think that's been the real big difference, is that the cost, the barrier of entry is very, very low, and there are no consequences. There's no collateral consequences.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So would you consider COVID-19 a setback for the progress made throughout the years and the perspectives of Asian Americans?
That's a hard question. Yeah. On one hand, I would say, yeah, this is not good for us. This is, but on the other hand, I think Asian Americans have been too comfortable with where they are in our society. That in the past, I think a lot of Asian Americans actively refused to support other communities that were crying out for help. Whether that be the Muslim community after 9/11, whether it be the Hispanic community with Trump trying to build the wall, with the GLBT community, with the African American community, with any number of groups who say, I really wish you guys would stand with us. And the Asian American community says, yeah, we're okay. But I think sometimes, sometimes you need a punch to the face to realize you need to wake up. And I think what's happening now is kind of a punch to the face. The Asian Americans around this nation who were happy being comfortable, being wealthy, being confident in their place in our society, suddenly realize it's kind of all just a facade. It's a show. That when it comes down to it, when we now have become a convenient target for political gain by the Republicans, it's all fair game. Even though there are so many Asian and Chinese Americans who are Republicans and have donated to them and support them, and it means nothing. I mean, it's meaningless. And I think that what has happened recently has spurred the community into action, which is why I say, I don't know if this is a setback, because, you know, you get pushed back, you get knocked back a couple of feet, but you decide to march forward even harder. I'm not sure that's a setback. And sometimes you need that. Sometimes you need a wake up call. And I've seen Asian American groups in the last week come out and very vocally support the African American community and say, you know what? We're with you. We're standing with you. And I would say, that's progress. That's good. That's moving forward.
Yeah, that's great. And in what ways this pandemic has triggered Republicans and the president's policies against China, and in particular, like Chinese immigrants? What do you think about this?
Yeah, Senator Blackburn and Tom Cotton both have drafted and proposed a second Chinese Exclusion Act. You asked me a few years ago whether or not it's possible for the United States to even consider the possibility of a second Chinese Exclusion Act. I would have said, no, you're insane. You're insane. I mean, we've evolved so far past that that even discussing it offends me. But right now, here we are, 2020, and we're looking at a second Chinese Exclusion Act, one based purely on ethnic identity, you know, without any considerations to danger. But why should we be all that surprised? I mean, again, this is where I say, like, the Asian Chinese community, Asian community needs to wake up, because we've already done this. We've already done this. We already did this in the last 2 years. We had the Muslim ban. What's the difference? We had Trump's policy on the border, on the southern border, denying entry to people lawfully seeking asylum. What's the difference? It's all racially motivated. It's all discrimination against minority communities. And while it was happening, I think a lot of the Asian American community kind of looked the other way. And now it's come to our own doorstep. And I want to say that I'm shocked, but how can you be? So the answer is sometimes, look, China has always been a target, and you know, every person who runs for president, Democrat or Republican, goes after China. Okay, and this is not to say, and I'll be the first one to say, man, China does a lot of bad stuff. There's a lot of bad stuff, and I disagree on a lot of things that China does, including everything from the Uyghurs to Hong Kong to intellectual properties to just. I mean, we can just go down the list. But China is also one of our single largest trading partners. If you don't have China, go ahead and delete 80% of Walmart, because they wouldn't exist. And most presidential candidates, they'll go after China, they'll attack China like on the campaign trail. But once they become president, they pull back on their rhetoric, because they understand that, hey, this is not shooting ourselves in the foot. This is like cutting our own leg off. You know, it's a pretty substantial partner. And, you know, and this is what I always say to people when people talk about China. It's like, look, man, I get it. I understand that we don't like the way they do things. A lot of their ideals are antithetical to ours. But let me ask you this. If you want somebody to do something for you, are you better off threatening them or being their friend and saying, hey, we really want you to do better, and we think you can do better? And, you know, I know what my answer is, because, you know, I work in the criminal justice system. I work in the system of, hey, we can threaten you, we can hurt you if you don't do certain things. But things work out a lot better when people want to do things, when people want to improve. And I think there's a lot of room for both the United States and China to work together, to work out our own relationships. The United States is imperfect, just like everyone else. And there's we need to fix a lot of our own stuff. But at the same time, we can go to China and say, like, look, you guys need to do a better job with the Uyghurs. That's unacceptable. We can't be friends if you guys keep doing that. And I think that's a good position to be at, and not just threatening to throw bombs.
Yeah. So amid this escalating tension between China and the US, it seems like Chinese immigrants are in a very embarrassing position. So what do you think, like, is their role are, and like what kind of things they can do to do with this?
I don't think they're in an embarrassing position. I think other people think that they're non-Asians think that they're in an embarrassing position. Mm-hmm. And what my message has always been is, these are Chinese Americans. These are Chinese Americans. They have about as much to do with what happens in China and how China is run as if a white person is being held responsible for what Ireland does or what Great Britain does. You know, you can be proud of being of Chinese descent, of being ethnic Chinese and or any ethnic Asian groups, but it doesn't mean that we get. Why should we get held for the responsibility of what China does, right? Why is it only our group? Why don't African Americans get held responsible for what happens in Africa? Or why don't white people get held for what happens in Europe? Because they're Americans. And that's been my statement all along. It's like, dude, we're Americans. We're Chinese Americans, but we're Americans. And we don't answer, and we should not have to answer for what happens in China just because we're Chinese descendants.
Yeah, absolutely. So since you've mentioned that you've been pretty involved in immigration issues, I'm wondering, what do you think this pandemic has influenced the US future immigration policy?
That is definitely not good. One of the biggest problems that I've been made aware of is that a lot of the Trump administration has used this opportunity to take actions against immigration policies that they otherwise probably couldn't have gotten away with. I don't know what it's all going to entail. A lot of it has to do with foreign students. A lot of it has to do with the foreign workers and things that almost universally from Democrats and Republicans that people like, if we start seriously excluding graduate students, doctoral students from other countries, we're screwed. Our country is going down. Because if you look at the programs for engineering, for mathematics, for physics, for any type of hard science, it's over 65% international. So students from other countries are coming here to study and get the degrees that Americans don't want to try to get because it's really hard. And then they're staying here and becoming the future engineers, the future physicists, the future whatever, to drive our economy forward. Because if you didn't have those people, there would be no buildings, there would be no products, there would be, no cars, there would be no a lot of things that we take for granted that we still can boast that we still make in this country. But you cut that off, they have other places to go. They can go to school in Canada. They can go to school in Europe. They can get degrees there. And then they can either stay at those other places or they can go home. This has already been a big problem because, especially in China and India, because of the booming economy in both China and India, a lot of the Chinese and Indian grad students who used to come here and stay here and be productive here are deciding to go back to where they came from. And so we educate them, we pay to educate them, and then they go home and make money in their own country. That's sort of a lose-lose proposition. If anything, I think we should be encouraging more high-level, high-education immigration, because that's what's going to drive our economy forward. That's what's going to build the future. It's not going to be our kids who just want to be YouTube stars. It's going to be the kids who are wanting and willing to study mathematics and engineering. I'm still hoping that our kids love science and at math, but it's hard to compete with YouTube, man.
Yeah, absolutely. So what do you think is the role and the impact of the government's communication on people's reactions to the coronavirus crisis? Like as a
policy? Sorry, I couldn't understand you.
Oh, do you want me to restate that?
Yes.
Oh, what's the role and the impact of the government's communication on people's reactions to the coronavirus crisis?
The government's role is to be a reliable source of truthful information, and they're not. And unfortunately, people have political agendas, and part of the problem with the coronavirus is that it's really either reset or upset, I don't know what the right term is, people's perception of what the government does or is. There's a lot of people, including myself, who thought that no, it doesn't matter who's in the White House, the government will always respond rationally it will respond in a way that protects the public and do the right thing. And I've been proven wrong. I did not believe that the White House mattered that much. I believe that a lot of what the federal government does, because it's filled with people who want to do the right thing, who are civil servants, who believe in protecting the country, that it'll take care of itself. But apparently that's not true. And actually, who's in the White House matters a lot. In terms of communication, I mean, it's lacking. It's lacking from at our federal level. It was lacking at our state level. That is the one thing that the government needs to do, is provide accurate information, unbiased information, like this is where it is, this is what it is, and this is where we want to go.
So as a policymaker, what do you think the government should do to tackle the racist and xenophobic sentiment during the pandemic and promote social cohesion?
Be a leader. What do leaders do? They set good examples. They set good examples with language and with action. Leaders push back against false information and provide true information. Leaders go out and try to build bridges with communities. And, unfortunately, you don't see that happening a whole lot. Not to be on a different topic, but like especially like on the George Floyd protests, right now you have President Trump not saying a word, and the words that he is saying are not helpful. They're actively hurtful, and they're causing more division and more strife. While President Obama had to write an op-ed and put it on Medium to do that role, to fill in that role of like, hey, a leader needs to come in and saying, I understand where people are hurting, and here's what we're gonna do about it. And, at the end of the day, what I'm looking for is good leadership.
Mm-hmm. I see. And besides discrimination against Asians during the pandemic, we also see how African American and Latin American communities have been disproportionately affected by the virus.
Yes.
In light of recent police brutality against African Americans, I'm wondering, like, in what ways do you think these events have revealed about the structural inequalities of the American society?
I think that the COVID crisis has revealed it to other communities. To the mainstream community, the African American community, the Hispanic community has always known this. They were never oblivious about the disparities with their own community and with race. It's just that we did not find out, we did not get the magnitude of the problem until this. Even before COVID, you could even look at things like heart disease, fatalities from heart disease rates, and you can see it within the African American community, there's a huge gulf that their numbers are far disproportional to what it should be based on population. I'm not sure what else to say. I'm not the right person to address the inequities for the Hispanic and African American community, but these are things that are long known for the people who have cared about this and for people who make it their business to know about it. It's just that everyone else didn't know.
Yeah, that's great. So what do you think Asian Americans could do more to promote social solidarity?
Reach out. Just at the very minimum, just a verbal acknowledgement, would be a great place to start. Just saying that you care and that you acknowledge other people's pain is a good place to start. It's not easy for people to, you know, figuratively put themselves in other people's shoes, because it's hard to imagine as an Asian the experiences of a Hispanic American or an African American or someone who's gay or someone who's Muslim. It's not easy to do that. Not impossible, but not easy. But you can say, I don't know exactly what your experience is, but I understand pain and I understand your pain. And, you know, I'll feel it with you. I think that's a good place to start. Beyond that, I think Asian Americans are just starting to learn to advocate for our own community. Still a little bit lumpy. But I think there's times when we can advocate for other communities. I'll tell you this, for the family separation policy at the border, two of the largest groups who came in out of nowhere that opposed those policies and provided resources, provided money, Japanese Americans and Jewish Americans. Mm-hmm. Because they get it. They can say, we don't know your exact experience, but we feel your pain because our community has gone through this. So I think one of the messages that I have for people throughout this is, you know, for all communities who are oppressed, for all communities who get ignored, or for all communities who get stepped on, that the type of bigotry and hate that's out there is all the same. The people who want the Muslim ban are the same people who are really adamant about building the wall, who are really, you know, really focused on calling it the Kung Flu, who are really focused on saying that Black lives don't matter. It's all the same people. It's all the same ideas. It's all the same thoughts. It's just that the names that they use and the people they target change over time. But it's the same game. And I think what we need to realize is that, especially for the Asian American community, is you could ignore it for as long as you want. But it won't go away until you take action. And I think the Asian American community is finally learning that just keeping your head down, as my family would say, don't rock the boat, doesn't fix anything. This is America. You don't speak up, then they assume that everything's great. And I think we're learning that you have to speak up. And you can't, but ultimately, you can't just speak up for yourself. You got to speak up against all injustice. Because if it's wrong against you, then it's wrong against them. So anyways, this discussion by itself probably would be like 4 or 5 hours, but that's, you know, anyways.
Yeah, definitely. So what do you think the future of Houston community will look like in terms of social interactions?
Good. More diverse, mm-hmm. More tolerant.
Okay.
I think Houston especially is a place that is comfortable with people and people who are different. And, you know, because like people don't know this, people think, oh, well, New York's really diverse. No, it's not. New York, Manhattan is like 75% white. Right, where in Houston, not only is like 50% of the population Hispanic, but it's not even all one Hispanic. It's not even all Mexican. We actually have large Central American and South American population, and everyone sort of has to learn to live with each other and tolerate each other. And I think that's awesome. I think the number of but it's not to say that it doesn't happen. It has not happened in Houston, but the number of the hate crimes against Asian Americans, I think, is less than other places. Because I think we have a population who just sort of like, yeah, what's wrong with Asians? We see Asian people all the time, you know, love going to Chinatown for food. So I think if you're racist and you hate Asians or you hate immigrants, you're not going to stay in the city very long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm glad to see that Houston is a very inclusive place. So yeah. Personally, what do you think you will start to focus on, like, in your work after the pandemic?
I'm going to go back to my same stuff. You know, one of the big things that we've realized, not just with the George Floyd stuff, but with the pandemic, is there's a real need for criminal justice reform. Mm-hmm. That we lock up a lot of people for no good reason. That, you know, especially in relation to drug crimes and other things, like, why are we putting them in prison for tens of thousands of dollars every year when we could just help them overcome their addiction, or we can just find other ways to deal with them, put them on probation or something? Why do they have to be in a cage? And we're going to keep working on that. You know, on the juvenile side, alone for kids, our county lockup is now under 100 kids, when 2 years ago it was like over 200, almost 250 kids. And everyone thought it would be the end of the world, but in reality, hey, everything worked out. Everything's okay. We're doing fine. And we're like, if it's fine now, why was it a problem before? And those are good questions to ask. And we want to ask those questions. And that's one of the things we want to approach, is like, you know, it's one thing to be forced to do something, but after the crisis is over, do we go back? If it works out well now, do we need to go back to where it was when it didn't work out well? And there's a lot of questions like that. I hope we can tackle it. And hopefully we can address it. We save the state their money. If we can keep, if we can do a better job of dealing with problems in our society, I think there'll be fewer angry people. I think there will be more equality. There'll be more justice in our system, and we would have maybe fewer riots.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I guess these are all my questions for today. Okay. Anything else?
I gotta go. I just made a good call.
Oh, okay. No problem. Thank you so much.